All right, so let's look at a cool example of evaluating a limit of indeterminate form. So our task is to evaluate the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 minus cosine x divided by sine squared of 3x. Now, whenever we see a limit function, we want to evaluate by plugging in the value that x is approaching, see if we get a valid answer. So when we do that, we plug in 0, and what would happen is we get 1 minus the cosine of 0 divided by sine of 3 times 0, all quantity squared, when we're evaluating the sine squared function. What's the cosine of 0? Well, the cosine of 0 was 1. So we have 1 minus 1 divided by, well, sine of 3 times 0 is anything times 0 is 0. So we have the sine of 0, quantity squared. Well, 1 minus 1 is 0, and sine of 0 is 0, and 0 squared is still 0, and we're left with an indeterminate form. So what do we do now? We don't give up, we have to try some manipulation. So here are the possible choices that we have when we're talking about evaluating a limit of indeterminate form. The first thing up is we try to factor if it's a polynomial function. We try to use common denominators if we've got multiple fractions. Can we use the conjugate, a binomial pair, to help us simplify to gain a trigonometric or a polynomial function that can be then factored or manipulated? These are the trig rules that we have to know. Most professors and textbooks only give you two of them. I'm going to give you four. So most textbooks only give you the first one and the third one, where it says the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 minus cosine x divided by x equals 0. So whenever you see this type of function, you can automatically say, okay, that portion, that little fraction itself is going to equal 0. But we can also say cosine x minus 1, because again, what's the cosine of 0 is 1, so 1 minus 1, doesn't matter which order it's in, is going to give you the same result. So both of these are, in essence, equally viable and you can use. Now, again, most textbooks and most professors will only give you this first manipulation when we're talking about the limit as x approaches 0 of sine of x over x. Whenever we have sine of x over x, it equals 1. We could also say x over sine of x. So I could also say the limit as x approaches 0 of x over the sine of x is also equal to 1. But after further study and more manipulation of trig rules, there is another one out there that's really, really important for us to know. So this rule is going to come up more often than you think. When you have the limit as x approaches 0 and you have a sine function over a sine function and they have the same power, so sine over sine, sine squared over sine squared, sine to the fifth over sine to the fifth, again, they have the same exponent power, then guess what's going to happen? All we're going to get to have to do is divide those leading coefficients and raise it to the power of the sine function itself. So this is a very powerful tool that we're going to want to utilize whenever we've got a polynomial, or excuse me, a trig function over a trig function. So going back to our problem, we recognize that it's a limit of indeterminate form. So we have to manipulate it in some way. Because we have 1 minus cosine x, we automatically think, oh gosh, wouldn't it be great if I can just utilize and get the x on the bottom and the whole thing goes to 0? The problem is there is no x on the bottom. It's a sine function. Huh. Well, if it's a sine function, I want to get an x on the top to help us out. Well, that's not going to happen either. And we have a sine that's raised to a power. So instantaneously, which one is the more dominant of functions? Is it 1 minus cosine x? Is it just sine x? Or is it the sine of the power? Which one's going to dominate or basically force the other one to do its will and its bidding? Well, the sine squared is the more dominant function. So we're going to want to see if we can come up with something that looks like this. In order to do that, we need to get a sine function in the numerator. Well, how do we get a sine function in the numerator? Well, we do know from our past exploration of trigonometry that we know that sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, which means sine squared x equals 1 minus cosine squared x. And that's a very curious manipulation. Look how similar those are. The only thing that's missing for me to be able to transform the numerator into a sine squared is it's missing a squared function. Well, how can I get that? I can use a conjugate. So what we're going to see is that this example is going to have to use two manipulations. We're going to have to use a conjugate to get to a trig. So let's go ahead and apply the conjugate to this property. So that means we have the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 minus cosine x divided by sine squared of 3x.
We're going to multiply top and bottom by the conjugate pair.
So we're going to multiply top and bottom by 1 plus cosine x. And again, we can't just multiply whatever we want to achieve what we're looking for. We have to only be able to multiply by the value of 1. 1 plus cosine x divided by 1 plus cosine x reduces to value of 1. And we can multiply anything by the value of 1 and nothing changes. But in doing so, we can do something very clever. So if we multiply those binomials together, look what happens. This becomes 1 plus cosine x minus cosine x minus cosine squared x if I distribute. The cosine and the negative cosine cross out, which means our numerator gets simplified to something more than just 1 minus cosine squared of x. Now on the bottom, I'm going to leave it as it is. I'm only multiplying the conjugate pair. The bottom did not produce the conjugate pair, so I'm just going to leave it as sine squared of 3x times 1 plus cosine x. Now, once we have used the conjugate, now we can use our trig relationship to manipulate the top. Notice, I can now replace 1 minus cosine x with what it equals, which is sine squared x. So let's go ahead and change that. That gives me the limit as x approaches 0 of sine squared x divided by sine squared of 3x times 1 plus cosine x. Now, we are super close to what we need. Notice down here that we have this, if we have a sine and over a sine with the same power, we can pull out those leading coefficients. So I'm going to rewrite this to make it more clear to what's actually happening. We have the limit as x approaches 0 of sine squared of 1x divided by sine squared of 3x times 1 over 1 plus cosine x. So I just basically rewrote that so it's more clear for us to what's actually happening. By doing so, notice what we can do right here. This is the same thing as this property. We have sine squared ax over bx. So we're just going to pull those leading coefficients and quantity square them. We can also evaluate this fraction all by itself. There's nothing wrong with this fraction because 1 plus cosine of 0 is no longer indeterminate. So that means we can say this is the same thing as 1/3, because again, I'm pulling those coefficients out quantity squared. I'm pulling out the square based off of the property. Whatever that exponent is, I'm going to square those leading coefficients. Times 1 over 1 plus the cosine of 0. I'm going to plug that 0 into that function, and I can evaluate. So now, what do I have? Well, 1/3 quantity squared is the same thing as 1/9 times 1 over, what was the cosine of 0 again? 1. So we have 1 plus 1. So it's 1/9 times 1/2, which gives us a value of 1/18. And this would be how we would utilize two different properties, the conjugate as well as our unknown trig rule for finding evaluating a limit of indeterminate form, to evaluate a function that looks a little bit more tricky than usual, because we had to be able to convert the 1 minus cosine to 1 minus cosine squared, change it to a sine squared, and then recognize our powers, recognize our trig rule to evaluate our function. And that would be how we simplify a limit of indeterminate form with two different properties.